Hi everyone, thank you for joining us on this first ever Suzy Customer Summit Fireside. My name is Madhu Iyengar. I'm the Director of Enterprise Partnerships here at Suzy. What I do is I work with some of the world's largest companies to develop and innovate their agile market research programs. This panel is specifically designed to give you insight into how Reckitt Benckiser, one of the world's largest health and hygiene companies, is staying close to rapidly shifting shopper sentiments and shopper habits. I'm joined on the stage, the virtual stage, by one of our closest partners, Nathan. Nathan's been a real champion in bringing the voice of the shopper early into the sales development cycle. But without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Nathan to introduce himself.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Madhu. So I'm Nathan Noertker. I am the team lead of Shopper Outperformance for RB on the health side of the business. Basically, that title just means that I handle anything national in scope, whether that is strategy, best-in-class processes, category growth platforms, macro trends, data capabilities, those types of things. So I'm glad to be here today. Thank you.
Super excited to have you. Great. So let's kick things off with a topic that's very top of mind for all of us right now. 2020 and beyond. Nathan, what were some of the key things you learned from 2020 and just the first few weeks of the new year?
Absolutely. We have learned that we have to focus on what our shoppers are telling us, given the ever-changing environments that they're dealing with. And the speed to getting answers fast has really increased like never before. When we think about the macro trends and everything that people are dealing with within their environment today, we've boiled it down to the three R's, not reading, writing, arithmetic, but actually risk, reinvention, and responsibility. And how do we understand what those things are that are impacting within each one of those buckets? And what we have found is it's really not solved by one vendor, right? When you think about an insights platform or the things that we need to do to answer those questions. But we really have to think about how do we create a quilt of insights, as that's really what our retailers are gravitating towards these days.
Very cool. Completely makes sense. Along those lines, with so much uncertainty still around COVID, not really knowing when things are going to be opening up, how are you shifting the way you're approaching insights in 2021?
Absolutely. This is all about more regular touch points with shoppers, consumers, and really limiting some of the one-off projects that we used to do in the past, right? We need to make sure that we are focused on, and the things that we've shifted are more in that ongoing understanding of what's happening within the shopper and consumer environment. We've really moved from doing things once in a while to now doing them quarterly. Like think about those bigger projects, what we used to do, to now more smaller, more regular projects, and really trying to understand that long-term behavior change. Also really moving towards always on platforms, right? That continuous panel of the ability to talk to our shoppers on a regular basis and or DIY, really allowing us to get a more continuous read on what is changing for them.
Especially when things are changing day by day and people themselves don't know what they're going to buy, feel, behave. Love that. I'm sure being in the shopper team at RB, selling Lysol wipes and Mucinex has been quite the journey over the last year. What are some of the largest shifts you've seen internally at RB when it comes to market research?
Absolutely. So I think what's been interesting for me is, and not just because this is what we do as an organization, but the crashing together of health and hygiene as the importance of what shoppers and consumers are dealing with has been really interesting for us. And we're well positioned to bring those insights and those learnings to our retailers, but it's elevated more so than it ever has before, anything that I've ever seen before. Really also getting deeper into the shopper sentiment tracking, really understanding the impact that that has on the future state of the business. You know, we've looked at behavior for so long from an actual volumetric standpoint to look at where the future of our business is, but we haven't really looked at the behavior from a basket impact and what those changes are from a shopper perspective and what that means for our business longer term. So that's one of the big shifts that's really happened for us and helped us to really identify how we work together better internally. And really, I talked about that quilting of insights. And if I had to pick one as the most positive change, it's this one, is really pulling those things together to build a more cohesive story for our retailers and help them understand what the opportunities are that they have and what they should be really thinking about within their stores.
Absolutely love that, because shoppers and consumers are, they could either be the same person or not, but they're very much related and they impact one another. So absolutely love that. Along those lines, one thing that I've been hearing a lot is that insights as a function is becoming more of a centralized function within large organizations. Is that the case at RB? What are your thoughts on that?
Absolutely. And one of the things I think that I have enjoyed, and I know that sounds really weird to say about enjoying from the COVID timeframe, but one of the things I really have enjoyed and what it's done for us is really to help us break down those silos within the organization. And what I mean by that, if you think of shopper and consumer insights, they were so separated, at least they were for us. And I've heard from other peers within the industry that they were having some similar challenges. And what COVID has really done is to help us understand that we need to work closer together. We've got to break down those insight barriers or those silos that we had built as an organization internally. Also, our Catman and leadership teams, if you think about shopper, consumer, category, and leadership, are all now working much more closely together than we ever have in the past. Also, when you think about the insights and why that's driving that, it's the consumer and the shopper are meshing now. One of the things and one of the ways I like to think about that is the at-home usage and attitudes, right? Traditionally, that would be, we would have looked at that as a consumer insight and something that the consumer team would really drive a lot of in bringing that back into the business. But what we found from a shopper perspective is that we're learning so much from that about how their attitudes, their behaviors are changing when they think about the products that they're buying, that they're using at home, and how that translates to in-store. So we're seeing a lot more usage of that by our shopper teams as well. And so there's a bigger need for us as an organization to partner on those types of studies. And I don't see this going away anytime soon. I really actually see this becoming richer. And what I mean by that is that combination of the two really helping us to grow and develop better insights as an org.
Love that. Completely makes sense. Well, 2020 obviously took all of us by storm. Now that we're a little bit more acclimatized to it, what are some of the newer pressures that you're facing this year that you weren't facing last year, and how are you dealing with those?
One of those I know that everybody in the industry, at least most of us, are dealing with, we called it the triangle of doom. Which is basically, if you think about the massive spike in sales that we had towards that March timeframe last year, was huge. We're not going to overcome that. So what does that mean when it comes to not only forecasting and sales impact, but budgets, when you think about what that's going to be? And so we have to think about how do we do more with even less in 2021 than we have in the past. The other one is really this difficulty in forecasting sales, right? Things were so different in 2020. Do you throw that out? Do you learn from that? What do you take away and really try to understand what was the one-off behavior versus really what's the longer-term shifts that are going to maintain? And how do we help the org and our retailers prep for that?
Yep, I totally hear you. Is there going to be another frantic rush to stock up on toilet paper this year? Let's hope not, but you know, you never know. But awesome. So as a leader in the CPG insight space, what I'd love to do is hear from you on where you think market research is heading in the next 5 or so years.
Absolutely. I think for me, it's the value of the continuous understanding, right? That continuous panel, that always on, will continue to grow. We have to make sure that we are understanding on a more regular basis what that sentiment is for shoppers, because the value in that to understand where our business is going is massive. Which that results in, you know, I'm going to date myself a little bit, you know, think about Top Gun, more need for speed, right? What the rapid insights, but the key there is not losing the quality within those rapid insights. A couple other things, really, I think we need, and I hope we will see a little less self-focused and a little bit more industry-focused. And what I mean by that is really that community of insights. We did some work around COVID where we were releasing things that we were doing out to the industry. And I think that that's something I would love to see happen even more, partnering with non-competes or other folks within the industry to pull our research together to really help ourselves and our retailers understand what is it that's transitioning for the shoppers? How do we help our retailers know what they need to do to really secure and to meet the needs of that shopper within their stores?
I love that. I love this whole concept of the community of insights. And I think a really great analogy is the community of scientists, right? Like the way everyone came together to release a vaccine the same year we saw a worldwide pandemic, that just shows how much we can do with collaboration. Love that, Nathan.
Absolutely.
Thank you. So what I'd love to do next, Nathan, is bring all of these amazing learnings to life by talking through a specific study you ran on Suzy. So, you know, much as I want to forget 2020, I'm going to ask everyone to think back to the start of 2020, like Feb, March timeframe. No one really knows, is COVID a thing? What's happening with it? So what were some of the specific challenges that you and your team were faced with as a shopper insights team?
Absolutely. So if I go back into February, right, when we're first really starting to hear a lot of things early February about coronavirus or about COVID, we started pulling together as a group and saying, what do we need to know? What are the questions that we would have? If this really takes off, what are the questions that we have? What are the vendors that we should tap into? How do we pull all of this stuff together? What does that look like within the organization? And I think some of the biggest pressures that we had was, how would we keep everyone updated on these latest insight changes on a weekly basis? And everything about how do you do that, right? So from an insights perspective, we weren't charged with releasing insights every single week until COVID hit. And I think that that's probably one of the biggest challenges that we faced was, how do we do that? What do we release to the organization to help keep them updated within this extremely rapidly changing environment?
Completely hear you. Why did you turn to Suzy to run your studies with these needs?
Exactly. So I think when you think about the speed, right? I think when I look at the traditional ways and methodologies that we would go and get insights from a qualitative and a quantitative nature, it was more around, okay, I gotta work with a third-party vendor, align internally. What are my questions? What are the things that I need to know? What is the goals and objectives for learning within the organization? Find a vendor to do that, get them on board with the objectives, help them, you know, then they go and work on a screener and pull together the questions. We do the statement work, we do all that kind of fun stuff, and they go off and analyze for a couple of weeks, and then it gets returned. With Suzy, it was something we already had available to us, right? We already had that capability, and we didn't have to go and pull together a statement of work. We didn't have to go through and rely on somebody else to do the analysis. We already had our questions figured out. So in February, when we worked through that and really tried to figure out, okay, what do we need to know and how do we bring this to life? That was already there. So we just had to go in and put it into the platform and release it. And so when you think about when everything kind of kicked off and went a little crazy, we actually were able to field something right away on March 20th and to really get that back in a couple of days and analyze that and have all of those insights right away versus having to wait for something a little bit more traditional in nature, which we would have normally done.
Interesting. So it sounds like speed was obviously very important here to keep up with everything that's changing. Just curious, how would you have approached this in a pre-Suzy world?
Exactly. Right. So it would be going out, getting that statement of work, working on it, and then turning the analytics over. And I think that one's one that is key for us. If you think about a DIY platform and the speed that Suzy actually allowed us to do was to do those analytics ourselves and slice and dice those questions, because we already had our screeners and we had everything in there that we wanted to learn and understand. And it was about really being able to grab out the analytics that we needed in order to answer those key questions, right? So in that traditional environment, you would wait and then, okay, yeah, but I need this changed, or I really want to answer this question. Can you redo it? We didn't have to do that. We could do it ourselves.
Right. It's really hard to predict every single question that you may need to ask, because a lot of it is sparked also by what you're seeing, right? And being able to do that iteratively, that's wonderful. You know, tell us a little bit about the actual study that you ran on Suzy.
Absolutely. So I mentioned March 20th is actually, so the 13th, 14th, you think back to about that time frame when everything was going kind of crazy. Like I said, we already knew the questions that we wanted to ask and what we wanted to understand from a behavioral standpoint. And so we actually dropped that on March 20th. Uh-huh. The study that you're about to see some top lines from is really being able to drop that right away. And we had all the list of questions. So we threw everything in there and trying to understand, what are they feeling? What are they going through right in this moment? And what are the things that we need to take from that and combine with the other data sources that we have to help our organization not only understand what was going on at that moment, but what were the potential impacts to our categories, our retailers, our sales over the next few weeks, few mm-hmm. months? Because think about that, at that point, at the end of March, beginning of April, we had no idea how long this would last, mm-hmm. right? So you're sitting there going, okay, what would I need to know? And so that was really what we fielded, was a lot of questions around our categories to understand why they bought what they bought, what their planned usage was, where, how much stock did they think they would have on hand, and a lot of things that kind of went into that, and utilizing the grid function and all the different things that are available to us within Suzy to really figure out what is going to happen to our categories and our business for the back half of the year.
Gotcha. That, yeah, I can imagine how difficult it must have been at the time to even think about forecasting. So super helpful. So tell us a little bit about your learnings.
Absolutely. So, and as you know, insights folks definitely don't like to make forecasts. At least I know. Like, no, but you have to kind of draw a line in the sand and help the business understand where you're going. If I think about the key learnings, these are broken up by category, and you'll see that on there because our categories are very different from each other. So in the first one, the upper left, the learning number one, what we found with that category is that from a behavioral standpoint, people were stocking up quite significantly. We saw that within the sales. We saw that in the units per shopper and what was happening within there. What we found, though, was that shoppers were saying, I'm not going to use this right away. This is something I'm going to have on hand just in case. I'm probably sitting on 6 months plus worth of inventory. And we really started to get concerned with this category specifically, going, oh, we think that there's going to be a significant reduction in sales within Q2, Q3, and depending upon how long this lasts. Again, remember, we were talking at the beginning of April. We were looking to say, okay, what happens in Q4? Anybody's guess. But we were really going, okay, if it continues, we're going to be challenged. If things go back to normal, maybe this category gets back into the green, but we kind of yellowed that one in Q4. Learning number two, that was a different category. What we were seeing there was, again, a lot of stock up, a lot of purchasing was happening, but this one was quite different. And what we were hearing from the survey was that people's attitudes towards the product and the category really shifted. And they started to think about, you know what, I've got about a month on hand of what I bought. That's what they were telling us. It might last me about a month. And because of the ways that they were viewing the category really shifted to, I'm going to consume this. I want to be proactive. I'm going to do something different than I have done on this one before, if we compare the feedback that we were getting. And so we were looking at the sales organization going, go. This one, you're good. The balance of the year, we think we're in a really good space. The third one, category C, you see there, we, again, people stocking up on this, we saw quite a bit of purchases, but the feedback we were getting from shoppers was, I'm not changing my usage. I just want to make sure I have this on hand, right? So what we were really looking at is, okay, so if they're not changing usage, this isn't going to, they're not going to drop, they're not going to increase. We know we can take what they purchased, figure out how much supply we think they have on hand, and then say, okay, to the org, Q2 is going to be a challenge. Q3, we think we're going to be in good shape. By Q4, we should be back to normal. The fourth one, the other category, people were purchasing. We didn't see quite as much stock up from an actual purchase behavior on this category. But what we heard from our shoppers within the Suzy survey was that they were not anticipating engagement within this category. during the pandemic. They were going to be challenged to utilize the things that they purchased. And the segments actually within the category were very different. So we were asking about the different segments within this unique category and really trying to understand what that impact was. And we were talking to the sales org and go, look, Q2 is going to be really rough. We think Q3 could be rough. Q4, depending upon, again, kind of like learning number one or category A, if things stick around, we're going to be challenged. If things get back to normal, we should go back to a positive space. But combining the behavior of what we saw from a purchasing standpoint with the insights from the survey to say what they were planning on using it, how their consumption or their attitudes were changing, really helped us determine what do we think we're going to see in the balance of the year.
Amazing. Another fun stuff. You ran the study early February, you mentioned March 20th. So you actually got to see how this played out. So next, would love to hear from you on what you predicted using Suzy and what actually happened.
Absolutely. So for that next slide, So for each of those categories, I talked about those. We had mentioned, you know, category A was going to be rough in two, it was going to be rough in Q3. Q4 could go either way. We just really weren't sure. And with the pandemic staying, we know, you know, we had told them that it was going to be a challenge. And actually what we saw in the actual results were double-digit declines for the entire balance of the year, which was exactly, you know, really along the lines of what we were saying was going to happen. Category B, you know, we had told them Q2, 3, 4, you're good. Go, sell, do whatever you want to do. We're going to be good in the categories. And we saw triple-digit growth in Q2. And that was after the big spike, right? So the big spike was in Q1. But even post that, we saw triple-digit growth in Q2. High double digits in Q3 and still mid to high double digits in Q4 for the categories. So massive increases there. That third category, you know, we had said going to be rough in Q2, right? The usage hasn't changed. They stocked up. What's going to happen? Q3 might get back to normal. It might still be a challenge. Q4, we think we're going to be good. Really close to this one. Actually, it normalized a little quicker than we thought it would there in Q3, and Q4 was back to flat. Unfortunately, that's normal for this category. So that would get us back to normal there. And then the last one I had talked about, that category D, if you remember from the last slide, was more about shoppers were changing their usage patterns on this one. They were really challenged on what they thought, right? Because the engagement on this one was quite a bit less. So what we saw there was Q2, Q3, we were challenged going, okay, we don't think it's going to be quite there. Q4 could go either way. And because the pandemic stuck around, we have seen negative all the way through. So we were thrilled to go back and do the postmortem on this to say, look, this is what we were flagging originally, looking at both shopper behavior and the sentiment side of what the shoppers were telling us in the Suzy survey. And the one thing I will say, I'll add on to this, with that survey we did, you know, I told you we did it March 20th, and we got some flack from the organization going, you know, that's really early. You need to relook at this and things are going to change. And what was fascinating is all the way through the year, every time we really went and tried to do, whether that was another, another type of study, or we revisited the Suzy surveys, or we looked at shopper behavior, everything pointed back to this original survey, and the things that we learned held true, which was fascinating and fantastic for us to see. It gave us a lot of comfort level in what we were doing and what we were pulling out of the data.
What an incredible story. Did you feel a little like Nostradamus just predicting the future like that, Nathan? So cool.
I told you, SI, we don't like to make those kind of predictions, but we were really vindicated to go, yeah, this is what we told you. We were thrilled to see that that's exactly, you're pretty close to what happened, as close as we can.
Very great. That's amazing. I mean, honestly, you pretty much were able to leverage Suzy and turn to the voice of the shopper, which was changing. Even they didn't know what they were going to do, but you were able to turn to the voice of the shopper as the source of truth. That's incredible. Last question for you. One thing that we hear a lot with like a quick agile tool such as Suzy is, what's the output like? Is it robust? Does it, you know, so you having used a number of different vendors, how do you think the output of Suzy compares to some of those more traditional vendors?
Absolutely. So I think the thing that I love is the ability to slice and dice and to cross-reference questions and responses and really get to some of the things that might be a little bit unique where you go, okay, the person answered this way on this question. How did they answer over here? And the ability to cross tab that on the fly, not only within the system, but taking out the exports. I'm an Excel nut. I love to take that out and do it myself. I think some of the things that were, you know, we still had as challenges or things we would like to see done, we're excited to know that are coming later this year. So thrilled about that. But I think just the ability that we have to take that out into Excel and to do some unique things really helps us dive into some really interesting learnings, but also to go back and retarget and question again if we go, oh, that's an interesting trend. Let me dive a little deeper into that. And then we can go back and retarget and ask some questions to those same folks to get a little bit more clarity.
Love it. Thank you so much, Nathan. This was amazing. I'm going to quickly check and see if we have any questions. It doesn't appear that we have any questions. So I think we are good. Thank you for your time today. Loved hearing from you. And we look forward to chatting more.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Of course. Bye, everyone.